Greetings. My name is Kevin Hoag, author of the textbook Vehicular Engine Design, published by Springer Verlag, Institute Engineer in Powertrain Engineering at Southwest Research Institute, and a founding faculty member of the University of Wisconsin's Master of Engineering in Engine Systems. Today I will provide a very brief snapshot of just one of many important trends in internal combustion engine development. The trend of which I speak is that of getting more work and power output from a given engine displacement. This can be thought of either in terms of power per unit displacement, or brake mean effective pressure, BMEP, which is really torque or work output per unit displacement. The reasons for pursuing increased specific output are many, all of which are part of delivering competitive advantage to the end user. Specific attractions include package weight and volume reduction, simply the cost of materials and production, and the fuel efficiency gains to be achieved through downsizing or right-sizing and downspeeding. Listed on this slide are a sampling of the engine applications where increased specific power or increased BMEP are being aggressively pursued. In this slide, the specific power output, power per unit displacement, in kilowatts per liter, is plotted versus engine rated speed for a wide range of current production engines. Each data point represents an engine as indicated by the abbreviated descriptor in the column at right. The engines were selected to be representative and to include both diesel and spark ignition engines, ranging from both economy and high performance cars to heavy duty and medium speed engines. A very consistent picture emerges, with the maximum specific output of naturally aspirated engines following a constant slope dependent on speed. Every data point to the left of the dashed line is a boosted engine. The circled data points are supercharged spark ignition engines, with all of the remaining engines turbocharged. Much more valid variation is seen in the boosted engines, where the specific output is now dependent on the magnitude of the compressor outlet pressure. The supercharged engines run at lower boost pressure, since the Roots-type compressors lose efficiency as the boost is elevated. From this plot, it is clear that there are two roads to increase specific power output. Increased engine speed, with its inherent disadvantages of reduced reliability and reduced fuel efficiency, or adding a supercharger or turbocharger to an engine at a given rated speed. This slide again shows the specific power output of production engines. In this slide, each data point represents an automotive diesel engine, where technologies are grouped versus time. The impact of various technologies on specific output are indicated by the color groupings. One begins at lower left with the last of the naturally aspirated automobile diesel engines. Prior to the plotted dates, most of the automobile diesels were naturally aspirated and not very powerful. Durability and fuel efficiency were their attractions. The orange data points indicate the wide introduction of turbocharged engines, with the blue region indicating engines that also featured an aftercooler, TCA for turbocharged and aftercooled. Electronic common rail engines began to appear in the late 1990s and resulted in increased combustion process control. The most recent change is the use of two-stage parallel or series sequential turbocharging, the ability to increase the supply and control of the charge air that these air handling systems provide has afforded the biggest specific output jump. This slide and several others that follow are from the reference book on the history of racing engines. These are 50 technically significant racing engines from between 1913 and 1994. They are high-end engines from venues such as Formula One and IndyCar. This slide again presents specific output, in this case versus time, but shows characteristics almost identical to the earlier specific output versus engine speed slide. Once again, all of the naturally aspirated engines fall on a single line. Admittedly, a direct comparison would show these all-out racing engines to fall on a line a bit higher than that for the production engines. That, too, can be readily explained, mostly in terms of volumetric efficiency, with a bit of friction reduction and compression ratio increase added to the mix. In this case, it is the data points encircled in red that are the boosted engines. Note, however, that in this plot, the abscissa is time instead of engine speed. That's a nice lead-in for the next slide. This slide shows the trends in engine speed versus time for the same 50 race engines. While there is a bit of scatter, mostly explained by the requirements of individual race sanctioning bodies, the upward trend versus time is clear and fulfills the picture suggested previously. Returning to the array of current production engines, the plot is now of BMEP versus speed. Where the earlier plot showed specific power, BMEP may be thought of as specific torque, or torque per unit displacement. Recalling that power is torque times engine speed, if the output is no longer speed dependent, the maximum naturally aspirated output is found to be independent of speed. Once again, a clear dividing line is seen, but this time quite independent of speed. Only boosting, supercharging, or turbocharging can be used to push the specific work output to higher levels. Again, the same trend is seen with the racing engines, and in this case, even the magnitude of the maximum BMEP line is almost identical to that of the production engines. It should be noted that the earliest engine shown predates knock measurement and the octane scale. Specific output was further limited by the necessarily low compression ratio, among other things. In this slide, the compression ratio of the racing engines is plotted, again showing the much lower compression ratios prior to the blending of fuels for increased octane in the mid-1920s. With octane blending, both a jump in compression ratio and the addition of intake boosting is seen. The upward trend in compression ratio with time probably correlates well with the increased rated speed, as engines are much less knock sensitive at high RPM. The boosted engines remain on a lower slope, nearly flat over time, as additional boost is seen instead of increased compression ratio. The conclusions we can draw to this point are summarized here. Many of you have heard the old adage, there's no replacement for displacement. For a naturally aspirated engine, that's true. While the energy is in the fuel, we need to draw sufficient air into the engine to completely burn the fuel and make its energy available to produce power. If the air is supplied from the atmosphere, there's only so much that can be brought in based on the displacement of the engine. But we do have one replacement for displacement, and that is to compress the air first using a supercharger or turbocharger. In the next few slides, I will present a very cursory look at the considerations involved in adding a turbocharger to an engine. This slide presents a map of turbocharger compressor operating conditions. Mass flow, corrected to a standard atmospheric condition, is mapped against pressure ratio, with the limiting conditions of compressor operation shown. The objective is to select a compressor that will allow the engine to operate near the heart of the compressor map, where its efficiency is highest, minimizing the turbine work that must be supplied and the resulting back pressure seen by the engine. We want to avoid overspeeding the turbocharger or running into conditions where it is choked or surges. Each of these conditions would be discussed in detail in our classes, but can only be briefly identified here. A breathing line can be calculated for the engine at each operating speed. The breathing line identifies the air mass that can be drawn into the engine as the compressor pressure is increased at any particular engine speed. Notice that the coordinate scale is the same as that of the compressor map. The engine developer works with the turbocharger supplier to overlay the engine's breathing lines on various compressor maps until a good match is found. If you remember the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears, compressor map too big, compressor map too small, compressor map just right. This looks like a very nice match that will allow the engine to run under boosted conditions between its rated power speed and the speed at which maximum torque is produced. The next consideration is how to control where on each of the breathing lines the engine will operate, how much pressure is needed at maximum power, and how much at peak torque. The power required to drive the compressor is supplied by the turbine, and so the equations presented on this slide must be equal. The turbine is sized to operate at sufficient inlet pressure based on the engine's exhaust temperature and on the turbine efficiency. A wastegate can be added to control mass flow through the turbine, or a variable geometry turbine can be used to control the turbine inlet restriction and the resulting pressure ratio. The result is summarized on this slide, where an engine operating map is shown in red, overlaid on a compressor map. The breathing lines are labeled as lines of constant speed, and the shallower red curves are lines of constant BMEP. This was a very brief introduction to an important engine development topic, perhaps whetting your appetite for more detailed explorations. The internal combustion engine continues to evolve and be refined. It is certainly not a dying product, even though its roles in society may change. And integration in an electrified product will change the demands placed upon it and the way in which it is operated. All of this points to the continued relevance of the University of Wisconsin's Master of Engineering in Engine Systems degree. Of course, this master's degree is only one of many engineering professional development offerings from the University of Wisconsin. There are three main segments in the UW portfolio, including online graduate programs, professional development courses, also known as short courses, that are held on campus in Madison or at various venues around the world for 2 to 7 days, and custom courses, which are designed for a specific company and held typically on-site. The common denominator is the application of expertise, which each portion of our portfolio highly stresses. The Master of Engineering in Engine Systems is one of several online Master of Engineering programs, as listed at left on this slide. On the right are several graduate certificate programs for those who have a desire for continued professional development, but for whom a master's degree is not of current interest. The Engine Design Certificate consists of 9 credits from the Engine Systems curriculum. I conclude with a further look at the MEES curriculum. The slide emphasizes the ability to compress one's learning on a timeline. I will add another perspective. In my experience in the IC engine industry, I have found that most engineers gravitate toward one set of disciplines, perhaps the thermal sciences and engine combustion and efficiency, or the mechanical sciences, hardware design, fatigue and vibration, or perhaps controls and electronics. Very few engineers gain significant background in more than one of these general discipline areas. But what are the technical skills needed to be a chief engineer? Perhaps not expertise in all of these areas, but a working familiarity, sufficient to know how these skills are integrated in the overall product, and the ability to converse well and ask the right questions of the subject matter experts. It is this breadth of understanding that the Master of Engineering in Engine Systems provides. Finally, this slide provides a few links from which further information can be obtained. I would recommend exploring these sites further and then following up with questions to the program's admissions counselor. I hope you have enjoyed this brief talk, and I thank you for your interest and attention.